Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Lumpim Vishum. Here are the top stories we're tracking for you on Monday, the 20th of July. MQM Chief Altaf Hussain announces fast unto death. Nepal begins process of public hearing for new constitution. And millions attend annual chariot festival in eastern India. And now for all the details, Pakistan's Mutahida Qawami Movement Chief Altaf Hussain has announced a fast until death in protest against the exploitation of the Muhajirs and the extrajudicial killings of his supporters by security agencies. A report.
Altaf Hussain said he will go ahead with the fast until death despite the appeal by the MQM leadership to call off the strike. Hussain, through a message from his London office on Sunday, had announced that he will sacrifice his life for the Muhajirs in Pakistan. He accused the intelligence agencies for what he called the genocide of the Muhajirs in the Sindh province. Muhajirs refers to the Urdu-speaking people who migrated to Pakistan from India in 1947 following the partition. The community, which has a large presence in Sindh, has been the traditional stronghold of the MQM. Hussain claimed that the MQM is repeatedly being targeted by the security agencies in the name of anti-terrorism operation. He also claimed that thousands of party supporters have been extrajudicially killed in the past few years alone.
Ahead of the monsoon session of the Indian Parliament, which is set to begin on Tuesday, it is expected to witness some storming action as the opposition is eyeing to corner the government over the resignation of tainted ministers. The government has, however, said it is open to holding talks with the opposition on all issues.
Sumitra Mahajan, Speaker of the Lok Sabha or the lower house of the Indian Parliament, held an all-party meeting on Monday to seek the cooperation of all stakeholders to ensure a smooth session. It was attended by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and senior leaders from major political parties. The ruling coalition, National Democratic Alliance, had held a separate meeting on Sunday to chalk out the government's strategy for what is seen as an all-out offensive by the opposition. It is expected to demand the resignation of Foreign Minister Sushma Swaraj, other than the controversy surrounding Rajasthan Chief Minister Vasundhara Raje and the employment scam in Madhya Pradesh. The main opposition Congress Party said it will raise the demand inside the Parliament.
Parliament se pehle jo log Lalit Gate mein involved hain aur jo vyapan mein involved hain un par karwai karni chahiye, unko action lena chahiye, unse istifa lene chahiye.
The government has finalized 35 items of business for the monsoon session, including goods and services tax and land bill. The BJP, which has thrown its weight behind the ministers in the eye of the storm, said there is no question of anyone resigning. Even though the BJP commands an absolute majority in the lower house, it is still a minority in the upper house or Rajya Sabha. The government said it is open to discuss any issues raised by the opposition.
As far as the government is concerned, I made very clear the government have nothing to worry, nothing to fear, nothing to hide, nothing to hesitate. We are ready to discuss each and every issue as per the rules and procedure and precedents.
He also said that the government will not bow down to the opposition pressure.
There is no question of accepting any ultimatum. Nobody can dictate to Parliament. Parliament is sovereign. We are an independent country and this government has got a clear-cut majority.
Stormy sessions are nothing new in the Indian Parliament. There have been occasions when an entire session has been washed out due to protests from the opposition.
At least 14 Afghan soldiers were killed in an American airstrike on Monday. The incident took place in Baraki Barak district of Logar province, some 50 miles from capital Kabul. According to reports, the airstrike was carried out at an army checkpoint after the US troops mistook it to be belonging to the Taliban. Central Logar province has been a traditional stronghold of the insurgents. A senior American military official confirming the strike said an investigation has been ordered into the incident. Former Sri Lankan President Mahinda Rajapaksa has promised a slew of populist measures in the run-up to the parliamentary election next month. The political battle in the country is becoming intense as the crucial poll inches closer.
Mahinda Rajapaksa is pulling all stops to get back to power after suffering a shocking defeat in the presidential election early this January. He has promised to increase the minimum salary of an employee to $185 if the United People's Freedom Alliance, under which he is contesting, comes to power. Rajapaksa, who kicked off his election campaign in Anuradhapura last week, is trying to play down allegations leveled on him by his political detractors. Even as the political climate in the island nation heats up, Rajapaksa's opponents are leaving no stone unturned to foil his comeback bid. The ruling United National Front, led by Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, is also making a volley of promises to have voters on his side. The Prime Minister has pledged full title deeds to ensure outright ownership of land to those who currently possess legal permits for their lands, which were given under state grants. He also vowed to give equal focus to agriculture, industries and tourism. Sri Lanka will conduct the crucial election on August 17th in keeping with President Maithripala Sirisena's promise of a new parliament soon after he assumed office in January this year.
Pakistan's illegal occupation in Gilgit-Baltistan has not only left the region underdeveloped, but it has also taken a toll over its heritage, culture and even sports, locals say. Here is a report.
Located in the Himalayas, the picturesque valley of Gilgit-Baltistan has stood the test of time, struggling to uphold its heritage. Its Shantur Top is the highest polo ground of the world, which has remained witness to hundreds of tournaments and matches. Present at an altitude of 12,500 feet above the sea, it is also called the roof of the world and used to attract tourists from faraway countries decades back. But Gilgit-Baltistan was occupied by Pakistan. Locals say that the area has faced complete neglect.
यहाँ पर कोई ऐसा स्टेडियम नहीं है कि यहाँ मुल्की सतह का कोई मुकाबले का इनकार किया जा सके, कोई ऐसा इवेंट रखा जा सके कि जिसमें पूरे सूबे से लोग शिरकत कर सकें या अंदरून मुल्क से लोग यहाँ आ सकें। पूरे पाकिस्तान के पूरे हर सूबे में जो है इस नौयत के स्टेडियम है कि वहाँ बैनुल अक्वामी मयार के खेलों का मुकाबला कराया जा सकता है लेकिन गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान वाहिद खत्ता है जहाँ पर इस किस्म का कोई स्टेडियम नहीं है और उसके अलावा ये बताता चलूँ कि पोलो जो यहाँ का मशहूर खेल है वो भी अब तबाही का शिकार है गिलगित-बल्तिस्तान में जो राजों के ज़माने से या आज़ादी से कबल के जो तारीखी पोलो ग्राउंड्स थे वो भी अब ख़त्म होते जा रहे हैं और उन पोलो ग्राउंड्स की हिफाजत बका और बहाली के लिए
The polo ground is present next to a dusty road, but the love for the game runs so much in the veins of people here that they travel from far-flung areas to watch whenever a match is played amid local music and drum beats. Bukhari, however, claimed the local government, which runs on instructions from Islamabad, does not provide any funds towards upholding the interest of the residents of Gilgit-Baltistan.
बदकिस्मती से अलमिया ये है कि यहाँ ये महकमा सिर्फ नाम की हद तक कायम है खेल और सकाफत का महकमा तो बनाया गया है लेकिन अमली तौर पर उसकी कारकर्दगी ना होने के बराबर है जो दिगर खेल हैं अगर उस पर भी हुकूमत तवज्जो दे तो यहाँ टैलेंट बेपनाह मौजूद है सिर्फ ज़रूरत इस अमर की है कि इन्हें मौके फराहम किए जाएँ
Gilgit-Baltistan, which was a part of India's princely state of northern Jammu and Kashmir, was illegally occupied by Pakistan more than six decades back. In the absence of basic infrastructure and connectivity and no heed from the administration, the region has now become a picture of neglect, trying hard to keep its traditions and culture alive.
Nepal authorities on Monday began the public consultation campaign on the preliminary draft of the country's new constitution. The government has declared a two-day national holiday to enable lawmakers to collect feedback on the draft from the masses in their respective constituencies. The first round of the campaign was, however, marked by some protests around capital Kathmandu and areas bordering India. The Sushil Koirala government had recently said that the draft constitution will be adopted following response from the public. Prime Minister Koirala has also promised to bring the new constitution at the earliest to end the prolonged political instability in the country. The first draft was presented to the Constituent Assembly earlier this month and is being deliberated upon. Once adopted, it will replace the interim constitution of 2007. Myanmar silently remembered its independence heroes as the nation marked its 68th Martyrs' Day. Residents and government officials paid rich tributes to the war leaders during the solemn ceremony.
Hundreds gathered at the city of Yangon on Sunday to pay homage to the fallen heroes, including Aung San, father of opposition leader Aung San Suu Kyi, who fought for country's independence. Suu Kyi paid floral tribute to the heroes at the Martyrs' Mausoleum in the city. Aung San has remained a powerful force in the politics of the country even after 68 years of his death. As Myanmar heads towards a crucial election in November, his image is poised to become a campaign tool among politicians. Suu Kyi said her party, the National League for Democracy, would bring a positive change that the country needs through the election. Aung San fought with the Japanese against the colonial British who ruled Myanmar, then known as Burma, during Second World War before switching sides to drive out the Japanese and set the country on the path of independence. On July 19, 1947, he was, however, gunned down along with other leaders of the pre-independence interim government by political rivals as they held meeting at the Secretariat. Aung San became a symbol of Myanmar's struggle for independence ever since.
Devotees throng the temples to pray to their gods, but during this time of the year, they say the Lord Himself comes to bless His worshippers. Take a look.
The annual festival of Rath Yatra or chariot procession is seeing a sea of humanity converging to pay obeisance to the visiting Lord. The mega festival that began over the weekend has brought nearly 2 million devotees in Puri, some 35 miles from Bhubaneswar, the provincial capital of eastern Odisha. The ceremonial event marks the journey of Lord Jagannath, his brother Balabhadra and sister Subhadra from the 12th century Jagannath temple to Gundicha temple, some 2 miles away. Devotees pull the nearly 45 feet high, splendidly decorated three wooden chariots carrying the deities known as Pahandi with thick ropes amid frenzied conch shells, beating drums and chanting of hymns.
इतना अच्छा लग रहा है इतना अच्छा लग रहा है ऐसा लग रहा है भगवान की साक्षात कृपा आज प्राप्त हो गई है ऐसा लग रहा है भगवान साक्षात कृपा करने के लिए हमें यहाँ पर खड़ा किया है ताकि हम डायरेक्ट से भगवान का दर्शन कर सकें बहुत अच्छा लग रहा है ऐसा लग रहा है जिंदगी आज ही सफल हो गई
जगन्नाथ की भगवान को खींच करके लाना पब्लिक के बीच में लाना ठाकुर को पब्लिक के बीच में ला करके ये संदेश देना है कि हमारे ठाकुर भी भक्त के लिए आते हैं पब्लिक को दर्शन देते हैं और पब्लिक के दुख को सुनते हैं
Many foreigners said the magnificent chariot festival brought them to India.
We are here to give our devotion to Lord. We are not allowed to come to the temple, so we are here to stand and to let Lord see us.
The 9-day visit of the deities to their maternal aunt's house situated at the Gundicha temple draws thousands to the holy city every year. According to Hindu religion, Jagannath, the reincarnation of Lord Krishna, returns to his home Vrindavan after a long gap during this festival.
Well, that's the way it was in South Asia this evening. Before we conclude the top stories once again. MQM Chief Altaf Hussain announces fast unto death. Nepal begins process of public hearing for new constitution. And millions attend annual chariot festival in eastern India. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/SAsianNewsline and follow us on Twitter at SAsianNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We will see you same time tomorrow. Good night.